और वुमेन डॉक्टर बीपी जोशी एंड अवर टुडेज चीफ गेस्ट डॉक्टर प्रभात रंजन सर, वाइस चांसलर डीवाई पाटिल इंटरनेशनल यूनिवर्सिटी आकुर्डी पुणे एंड ऑल डियर पार्टिसिपेंट. आई प्रसन्न लोहे बीइंग द को कन्वेनर ऑफ दिस सिक्स डेज एसटीटीपी ऑन कॉम्प्रेहेंसिव फ्यूचर इन आर्टिफिशियल इंटेलिजेंस वेलकम्स यू ऑल इन दिस इनॉग्रेशन सेशन. We will have our traditional auspicious lamp lighting ceremony as a tribute to Mata Saraswati. Give us wisdom to make this world a better place. May all human beings live in harmony with nature and other form of life. Here we are doing the inauguration by digital lamp lightening in the presence of dignitaries. I request my technical team or the digital lamp lighting. Vam kalyanam aarogyam dhana sampada shubham kurutvam kalyanam aarogyam dhana sampada shatru buddhi vinashaya deepajyotir namostute. ज्योतिर्नमोस्तुते शुभं कुरुत्वं कल्याणं आरोग्यं धनसंपदः शुभं कुरुत्वं कल्याणं आरोग्यं धनसंपदः. Thank you. We have received the overwhelming response for the many states of India. The aim and objective to organize this STTP is to create awareness about the future of artificial intelligence in comprehensive domains. I would like to request the convener of this short-term training program, Professor Sakshi Khamandkar, to brief about the STTP and the details about it. Sakshi ma'am.
Thank you, sir. A very warm good morning to all. I, Professor Sakshi Khamandkar, on the behalf of Computer Engineering Department of Cummins College of Engineering for Women, Nagpur, and convener of this STTP, welcome you all in this knowledgeable journey of 6 days STTP on comprehensive future in artificial intelligence. It's my pleasure to welcome all the eminent speaker and guest from all over the country, from different walk of life. You have come here to share their knowledge with participants. We are proud to announce that this STTP conducted along with the cooperation of Zensar RPG Foundation, Evolving X and IT organization, which are our knowledge partner and technical partner. We received a huge response from all over the country. In today's era, the main outcome of this STTP is focusing on the features of artificial intelligence in different aspects. Our very first day, we have a guest of honor in today's inauguration function is Dr. Prabhat Ranjan sir, Vice Chancellor of DY Patil International University. He has a vast experience in this field and he is the innovation of the AI branch. Then in the second session of the first day, we have Mr. Rizwan Ahmad, who is the Chief Technological Officer of Dell Plus. He is also having the more than 20 years experience in the field of production and IT. On the second day, we have two eminent speakers. In first session, we have Dr. Khotri sir from Shri Sant Gajanan Maharaj College of Engineering, Shegaon, who has more than 15 years experience in the field of artificial intelligence, and he delivered the lecture on data extraction for AI using MATLAB. In second half, we have Dr. Amit Andre sir, who is the Chief Executive Officer, Vinci USA. He delivered his session on the machine learning with AWS. On the third full day and the fourth day of the first session, we have Dr. Pooja Jain Ma from IIIT Nagpur. which has a big experience in the field of AI, taken the session on dividing the into the machine learning, where she handled the machine learning algorithm and its application with hands-on. On the fourth day, in second half, we have Mr. Sharandhar Sharma, who is a senior technological program manager in Atma Technology Bangalore, who is focusing on the industrial approach of the artificial intelligence. On the fifth and sixth day, we have a great personality, Mr. Bhagwan Kommetti, who is a director of product engineering at Value Momentum. He's also a TEDx speaker, and he's a founder of the first quantum computing startup in India, who is more than 20 years experience in the product and IT services. So we hope that these 6 days ACTP would help participants expand their knowledge in the field of artificial intelligence. I request all the participants from across the country to make use of these 6 days ACTP to the best of their abilities. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Over to Prasanna, sir.
Thank you, madam. For the detailed description about the STTP and the complete program of short-term training program. Today, it's my privilege to introduce today's chief guest, Dr. Prabhat Ranjan, sir. He is a Vice Chancellor of D.Y. Patil International University, Akurdi, Pune. Today, he received the most prestigious award, that is, Most Emerging Higher Education Institute of the Year Award for D.Y. Patil International University. This award is given by EdTech 11th Indian Education and Awards 2021. Dr. Prabhat Ranjan, sir, is a nuclear fusion scientist, a futurist and educator, an innovator, an entrepreneur, and a science communicator. For last 5 years, he was heading India's technology think tank, TIFAC, that is Technology Information Forecasting and Assessment Council in Delhi, as its executive director. TIFAC is an autonomous body of Department of Science and Technology of Government of India. TIFAC developed Technology Vision 2035 during his tenure, which was released by Honorable Prime Minister in January 2016. Prime Minister Office has directed all the department and ministries to follow this document and take the agenda forward under leadership of Niti Aayog. Earlier, he worked for nearly 20 years making important contribution to nuclear fusion research as a scientist in India and USA. After this, he worked on Chandrayaan 2 mission, wildlife, agriculture, and brain-computer interface. He has brought smile on faces of many persons with severe disability by innovative assistive technology for more than 11 years. As far as the education, he has completed his PhD from University of California, Berkeley, then Master's in Physics from Delhi University, Bachelor's in Physics from IIT Kharagpur. As far as his job and employment is concerned, now TIFAC, he's an executive director in Delhi from 2013 to 2018. Then Dhirubhai Ambani Institute of ICT Gandhinagar as a professor. Then Institute of Plasma Research Gandhinagar as a scientist and project leader. Saha Institute of Nuclear Physics Kolkata as a scientist. Lawrence Berkeley Laboratory, USA as a research assistant, and University of California, Berkeley as a teaching assistant. His research areas are wireless sensor network and embedded system, applications to planetary explosion, wildlife, nuclear fusion, assistive technology for persons with severe disability, and brain-computer interface. As far as the research achievements are concerned, if we are considering the nuclear fusion, he is a major contribution to improve both the first generation experimental nuclear fusion reactor in India to international standard of operation. and design real-time control system for India's first supercomputing Tokamak SST-1. As far as the planetary exploration is concerned, he designed LuSEX-X to carry out lunar surface of subsurface exploration for Chandrayaan-2 mission at request of Chandrayaan mission director. Work on lunar seismic sensor network to monitor seismic activity on moon. He worked to detect water in the shadowed crater of moon. In assistive technology, he developed a device to improve quality of life of person with severe disability using body, brainwave, and touch sensor. As far as the wildlife is concerned, he developed wireless sensor network technology for tracking wildlife for 4 groups of animals: GPS-based, GPS-less, image sensor-based, and acoustic sensor-based. He has received many awards and many academic achievements. As far as he visited various countries for the research and education purpose. He is also a member of various external bodies and committees. It's a great pleasure for all of us that, sir, you are today our chief guest. So I request you to guide us and please start your keynote session.
Thank you. Thank you for the kind introduction. Let me try to share my screen. Is my slide visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so just now it was mentioned about an award. I was just waiting that event because due to which I got late. So it's probably you can see it on the screen saying Most Emerging Higher Education Institute of the Year Award. AIST Chairman Anil Sahasrabudeva was there to give this award. Thank you for informing this. My own linkage with artificial intelligence goes back to more than 20 years when I was using neural networks on nuclear fusion reactors, and we had about 4 papers around year 2000 in some of the reputed journals. Of course, that time at a very early stage. Now we are seeing that a lot of people are referring back to those work that we had done 20 years. But artificial intelligence, I have another link, and that I would like to mention here quickly, was that as head of this particular organization, TIFAC, which was mentioned, we prepared this document, Technology Vision 2035, and we had seen what kind of changes that are happening in next coming 15, 20 years of time scale. And that was the basis of this document. As was mentioned, this was released by Prime Minister 5 years ago in 2016 on 3rd January in Indian Science Congress in Mysore. And the Prime Minister wrote forward to this document as well. When we're preparing this document, we looked at what should be the objective of designing India's future. I'll come back to AI. And we said that we'll not talk about money. We will not talk about who is poor, who is rich, but we'll focus on quality of life of Indian citizens. So there was another document of similar kind prepared by TIFAC that was released in 1996. That was called Technology Vision 2020. That time, Dr. Kalam used to be our chairman. During my tenure, Dr. Anil Kakodkar was chairman. So between Technology Vision 2020 and 2035, we changed our thought process. We said that let's not focus on country, let's focus on the citizens. So we moved from India to Indians, and we focus on Indians, our quality of life, and we've defined 12 parameters, which we call prerogatives. 6 of them are individual, 6 and collective. I will not go into the details, but each of these, there is a certain quantitative requirements from the countryside, and there are certain qualitative requirements for the country. For each of these, we have also prepared a technology table at different stages. And for example, this is about quality education. There's a technology table like this for each of these. Similarly, there are 10 grand challenges that we have defined for the country. For example, first one is guaranteeing nutritional security and eliminating female child anemia. I'm happy to inform you that this one sentence has led to 2 major missions countrywide. One is called Anemia Mukt Bharat, other is called Nutrition India. So both of these happened, and there are many other things that have happened or which are happening in country have happened because of this document, Anemia Mukt Bharat, Nutrition India. This document is supported by roadmaps in 12 sectors to achieve this vision, and I put education right on the top. So education was right on the top of my list. So when my tenure got over, I wanted to come back to education, and that's why I wanted to come back to university as a vice chancellor. When we're preparing this document, we noticed two things. One was technology happening much faster than we imagine or expect. Second, technology diffusion is also happening much faster. This also means that technology obsolescence is very, very high. This has impact on our education, because when you are trying to start a curriculum, 4-year program, by the time a student graduates, the things would have changed. So we need to have flexible curriculum to respond to this. NEP 2020 has talked about this, and I hope that countrywide things would change. I would talk about what we have done and how it has led to change countrywide. In fact, that's the reason we got this award today. Now, I just wanted to mention to young people is that when we work on such document, and it's also important for young people to understand that how do we foresee future? What is the way we do this? There are various ways, I can't go into details. One is called horizon scanning. Horizon scanning means that we keep track of technology as happening across the globe. And there's a method to do this. In fact, I personally do this all the time. Second, that we look for weak signals. These weak signals are those which are missed out by experts in that sector, because, for example, 3D printing technology was developing, but it may have major impact on healthcare sector. That linkage people don't see. So we try to recognize those signals. And more often than not, it's the combination of technology that happens, which is very important. For example, today we are using this particular platform. It would not have been possible unless we had good internet access, the camera, and many other technology that is becoming available today. Similarly, if you look at, for example, Ola Uber kind of services, it was not possible unless we had mobile phones, unless we had mobile phones with GPS, we had internet connectivity everywhere, we had Google Map kind of thing. All of these technology come together to make certain things possible. So when you look at what is likely to happen, you would also need to look at the combination of technologies. I'll just give a quick example of how did GPS come into mobile phone. In the US, there is an emergency line number called 911. When you dial that number, it goes to emergency system and they respond to that. Earlier, it was landline phone number. So every landline, they knew which is the location. So when you call, they will come to know the emergency handling team that this is the location from which call is coming, even if they are not able to give you the location because of a certain situation they find itself. But mobile phone being movable, it was difficult. So US government required that you must have a GPS in each device, and that led to this big change that we are seeing. There's another exercise we do is scenario building, where we look at, you know, if this happens, then what's going to happen? We try to build scenarios. So these are some of the ways we try to foresee future, and that was the exercise we did. Now, if I look at artificial intelligence, you are going to be listening to a lot of experts. I'm not really an expert in that sense. But for example, if you go back 300, 400 years, 500 years back, we had Guru Shish Parampara, which was based on a guru teaching a small number of students. It was a flexible system. The guru had to be satisfied with the system in the sense that the guru had to be satisfied the child or the disciple has learned everything else, and then only he or she would be graduating. Today, what happens, you get into a 3-year or 4-year program, and then it's like assembly line, you get out. But in that system, which was personalized, you could actually be either finishing 6 months or 5 years, depending on the guru, when he or she was satisfied. But today, using artificial intelligence, it is becoming possible to this personalized learning is starting to become possible, and more of this is going to be happening. Similarly, AR, VR is coming together with AI to actually make learning possible. And actually, this is how we are going to be seeing the future happening. And COVID has shown some of this already. For example, in this particular case, you see that somebody learning atomic structure using augmented reality headset. And we are going to see holographic devices also coming to our room, where a teacher through hologram would be available to us, talking to us in our language and interacting to us. Let me come to one more area where we actually talk about self-driving car, where AI has a big role. And there are different levels of this, but there's a statement by a gentleman. He says that once you trust a self-driving car with your life, you pretty much will trust artificial intelligence with anything. So if we can trust, because we are giving our life in the hand of artificial intelligence, because a vehicle, if it meets with an accident, then our life is threatened. So there are different levels. I'll not go into the details. Level zero is where driver is doing most of the tasks. Level one is where actually drivers are being assisted. For example, my daughter is in the US. And when I go there, her car gives us her warning that in case she's coming close to the lane, another vehicle coming, or she's trying to turn and there's another vehicle there, to give a warning. But all the control is in the driver's hands. This is level one. And level two, where driver car can drive alone, but driver has to present in case some system starts to fail. And there are a few examples of this. In level three, driver can entirely disengage, but it has to be present to foresee any failures. And there are examples of this. Level four is where you can fully drive the thing in certain areas, certain cities, certain states, but not anywhere and everywhere. The level five is where actually it's ultimate level of autonomous transportation, which requires zero human interaction. And this example, for example, have a robotic taxi, or we have delivery systems like Amazon and others are working on that. Elon Musk is claiming that they're almost close to achieving this. That means that you could sleep in a car and reach your destination. This is not only taking you from one point to another point, but it has many, many impact. For example, if I'm able to do that, I would suppose I go to a city for a meeting. Let's say I'm in Pune and I go to Mumbai for a meeting. Instead of sleeping in a hotel in Mumbai, what I would like to do is to sleep in the car, and it will travel back by itself to my home, and I can take rest. So this will mean that all the motels and hotels would have tremendous impact. So when a new technology comes in, it actually impacts large number of things, and new possibilities emerge, and at the same time, other possibilities go away. So there's a lot of disruption that happens. And so students need to be aware of this, that if something is going to happen, how it's going to disrupt our future job profile and our business potentials. Another technology area that is coming is combining. I'm just giving you a few examples. For example, these pictures are not real pictures. These are generated through what is called deep fake. So it's combining deep learning and fake together, which makes sure that actually you can look at somebody as if he is speaking something. There will be a lot of examples of that for the last 3-4 years. I'm again not going to details of these because short is the time. But around 2003, we were working on a project with Reliance, which was to actually develop language translation on real time so that you can call a customer care and it's the computer will be talking to you in the language of your choice. We worked on 10 Indian languages. At that time, we had access to a system where actually you can train the system with 2 hours of speech and then you can make it a speech, anything that you like. And today actually it's happening that you can make somebody's video also. And in fact, I wanted to show you a video, but there was some technical problem of my grandmother, of whom I had a black and white photograph only. I could change it to color and actually make her move like a video. And so these kind of things are becoming possible today. Similarly, caring for elderly, an area that I have worked for a long time in the disability sector, it's become very important that artificial intelligence with the help of robots can help senior citizens. And in COVID era, this became very, very important that even if you were present there, you were young, but you needed a non-human being to take care of you in both hospitals and so on. So a lot of work started in this direction. So in the COVID era, this became important, not only for elderly, but everyone. The defense sector, there's a lot of potential that has happened because of artificial intelligence. One is battlefield surveillance that is happening, getting up-to-date information using drones and other places, which can actually look at the data and actually issue alerts as well as identify areas of strategic importance. Intrusion detection is something that's also very important. I've worked on this area for last maybe 13, 14 years to help intelligence agencies, where we combine multiple sensors to detect intrusions either within the country or at the borderline. And this, again, AI using multiple sensors can play a very important role. I'm in Pune, close to Mumbai, which is the film industry hub of the country. Film industry itself is likely to see many, many disruptions because of this. For example, you look at different aspects of filmmaking, starting from writing scripts, to simplifying pre-production, to casting actors, to composing music, to editing movies, to promoting movies. Each of these, there's a role of artificial intelligence. Again, I'm not going to go into details, but actually it can assist us in writing scripts, and you can also, you know, ask you questions and create, you know, ask doubts if they have. This can be done by AI system on the script. Similarly, you can simplify the pre-production process, identify locations, schedule, you know, shooting and so on. As you might have heard, some of the big Bollywood stars, they don't have time to give to the producers, so they'll give after 2 years or 3 years. And this can all be helped through pre-production systems using AI. Similarly, for casting purpose also, it can be done. And certain times, what happens is that you can identify the actors, which area they're popular or which language is their best, fan following. And you can accordingly plan movies. Today, we are starting to see a lot of this happening that, for example, even cricket commentary, you can listen to in different languages. That's, of course, live people are there. But movies today, you can see in many cases, you can see in any language of your choice. And I do that on some of the online channels. You can also help with casting of actors. Actually, you can have digital actors at the same time. It is possible that in an unfortunate situation when an actor expires while the movie is not finished, it is possible to create the actors digitally also. It's also be able to possible help in music itself, composing music, editing movies, and promoting movies. All of this is possible today due to AI. One very important area and very important for India actually is language translation. India has a multiple, we have multiple languages. Well, we have more than 20 languages in the constitution, but actually there are 400 to 500 languages spoken within the country. And it's very difficult to go from one region of country to another region. You might find it difficult. And of course, if you travel across the world, you may find it difficult. You go to China, you may find that English is not the best choice, or is Korea or Japan, or even Germany for that matter. So today it's starting to happen that artificial intelligence translators are surpassing human translators in their ability to accurately translate foreign languages. Alexa, Google Home, these are all important things where actually you can interact with them in language of your choice. Earlier, you know, 5, 6, 7 years ago, when we saw these systems first, we had to actually, they could only recognize in American accent. But today, actually, you can talk in Indian accent. They recognize perfectly well. At the same time, you can, for example, speak in Hindi. It may recognize. A Nigerian man, actually, Nigerian, I should say, scientist, developed one of the first intelligence portal, AI portal, that can translate over 2,000 African languages. And this actually removes the barrier, language barrier in Africa and rest of the world. In terms of Indian language, as I talked about, what we have seen that we can use advanced AI for this purpose. And into the technology vision 2035, we had actually put one technology requirement that was real-time translation among Indian languages. Real-time translation among Indian languages. And actually, what we wanted that if I'm speaking, say, in Hindi and somebody else wants to listen to Marathi, you should be able to translate that very fast in a more accurate way. Normally, what was happening was that we were translating Hindi to English and then English to back to Marathi. So that was actually not a good thing. So we said that let's have a real-time translation among Indian languages. We need to identify the pivot language. And we had discussion in Delhi in 2016. We had discussion with the ministries. And we have invited Google, Microsoft, and other agencies along with ministry agencies. And actually, a lot of work started to happen. I'll just show you some examples. And in 2021-22 budget, National Language Translation Mission has been announced, which actually will use artificial intelligence, machine learning, and speech recognition technology to build the next generation government apps and websites based on this. For example, Microsoft has Indian languages work going on, Google has going on, which can translate, you know, the language translation among Indian languages very easily. Another interesting area is whether an AI system can develop emotions or feelings.
Excuse me, sir. We had discussion on this. Slides are not changing.
Slides not changing?
Yeah, yeah. Otherwise, we can share it again.
I should have told me earlier. Sorry. Sorry. Just once. Let me change the slide. Is it changing now? Is the slide changing?
No, sir, no. It's the same.
Okay. Not changing?
No, sir.
Just is it yeah. changing now?
Now it is changing. Yes.
Okay, sorry about this. I didn't but realize.
Not in the presentation mode, probably. Yeah. Now it is okay.
No, I'm in Linux. Sometimes this happens. Anyway, so I was talking about artificial intelligence, whether we can have emotions or feelings in artificial intelligence. I had a nice discussion on this in Delhi. I'm not going to do details. Those are there on the YouTube. There was divided opinion on this. But for example, this is a scene from a movie called Ex Machina, and actually where this lady robot starts to develop feelings. And it's an interesting movie to look into that. There are other movies like this also that have come up. We still are not sure whether we'll have emotions and feeling in the AI system. And there are two groups of people. One group says that yes, it may be possible. Other group says that it may not be possible. We had in 2015 discussed a future of brain, a race between mind and machine. Delhi, it's on the YouTube, and you can find a lot of discussion on this from different points of view, from biological point of view, from neurology point of view, from cognitive science point of view, and a spiritual point of view. There's also discussion going on whether we can achieve digital immortality through a digital avatar, and there are four variations of those. I'm personally working on Avatar C. And this was triggered by Dr. Kalam's unfortunate death in 2015, and he was my ex-chairman. So I said that, can we create digital avatar of Dr. Kalam? This will require multiple technology coming together, for example, holographic systems, speech recognition, speech synthesis, and artificial intelligence. And it's a combination of each of these exists today independently. We need to combine together. And that's what I was talking about, that you need to combine together technologies to make it possible. So I'm working on this. Another area that is happening is called neuromorphic computing, where actually we are trying to produce computers which will work like brain. And a lot of development is happening in this. In fact, IBM had been working some of this for a long time, and new technologies are coming in today. In fact, just yesterday I was seeing some electro-optical systems are being planned out. This will actually, just like our brain, you know, if you think of normally what is happening in today, a lot of computing that happens in AI, actually you need to go to cloud to do that computing. It is not at the edge device. But as a human being, I'm collecting all the data myself, and I'm actually doing the calculations within my brain. So this is much faster, much more reliable. But what happens in the cloud, if you go, your internet connectivity may go down, or the response may be slow, and so on and so forth. So through the edge devices, if I can create these AI systems which can be put in the edge devices, then the improved performance of AI system improves, and neuromorphic computing is likely to take us towards that direction, in addition to many other things. For example, as a human being, we can, our vision is much, much better, or even hearing abilities and recognizing of sounds is much, much better as compared to computers. So this may lead us to that. So with all of these things, the future is digital actually. Digital health revolution is taking place. Digital manufacturing is taking place. Future of business is digital. Supply chain is digital. Finance is digital. We have seen all of this happening today. In fact, we hardly carry notes today in our pocket. It happened in two phases in India. We had the demonetization, I think it was 2016, and then recently COVID, we didn't want to be in contact. So now we forget that we have to carry some currency notes. We're mostly using apps to make payments. When culture is digital, future of fashion is digital, which means that we also as a university, as education system, we need to change ourselves towards digital future. So I just try to end my talk by just mentioning a few things of what we are trying to do at my university, D.Y. Patil International University in Akurdi campus of Pune. In 2019, we created a BTech Computer Science Engineering to cater to this kind of change that was happening. We created a multi-track system where first 2 years are common and last 2 years you have option to choose your track. I'm not going to go into those details. But AICT actually appreciated this, and actually formed a committee to revamp the computer science engineering curriculum of the country. I was a member of that. This led to complete change in 2020. 5 to 6 new programs started, and hundreds of institutions across the country followed that. And what is this particular system? So it has 10 tracks: artificial intelligence, machine learning, data science, robotics, and AI. Intelligent transport system with integrated MBA in transport logistics management, Internet of Things, cybersecurity, fintech, again with a 5-year integrated MBA in fintech, bioinformatics, cloud and systems administration, web and mobile application with a possibility of integrated masters in design, AR, VR, holographic and games design. These are the 10 different tracks. The students can choose a track after 2nd year to give the flexibility. And these tracks can be adjusted, you know, edited, modified, or added as the curriculum is going on. So when you take admission, you don't have to make this choice. And we also have the flexibility to adjust these things as technology changes. In addition to computer science engineering, students learn electronics and communication because we need to combine all of this together. We also bring in computational thinking. One more thing I'd like to bring in that to students also, we actually make them familiar with what is the concept of design thinking and fabrication lab. In fact, I'm chairing a committee of AICT to set up idea labs across the country. Just on 14 June, we selected 49 institutions across the country. And in fact, today evening for 2 hours, we'll be interacting with the colleges that have been selected under this. This is actually basically a fab lab with many things like 3D printers, laser engravers, and so on. And a lot of this is supported by projects at different stages. Again, I'm not going to go into details, but embedded system, artificial intelligence, and security is all part of core courses. We also make sure that students learn about technology, commercialized, entrepreneurship, because we would like to have more students creating jobs rather than becoming job seeker, and team teaching as well as focus on climate change and sustainable development, environment science is part of this. One more interesting thing that I'd like to share with all of you, and we're trying to promote this through Idea Lab of AICT also, the concept they have is called Lab in the Bag. It's a small device which we use in our labs, which the students can buy, and then they can carry it anywhere just like a smartphone, and they have everything on their computer, which would be then electronics labs, oscilloscope, functionator, multimeter, digital input, output, analog output, and so on. And this will actually make sure that you can continue to do projects just like software projects, you can do hardware projects. And in COVID era, this became very, very important. So we are trying to promote this also. My university started in 2019. We're trying to promote this through Idea Lab of AICT as well. This is a letter from AICT for appreciation. This is a working group suggest new areas, which I was a member. On a similar line, we started in 2020, BTech Bioengineering with 4 different tracks and MBA Digital Business. So that's the end of my talk. I'll just summarize the thing, saying that technology is happening at a faster rate than we expect. Technology foresight is much more important than in the past. Invention and innovation backed by IPR protection is going to be critical for India to move ahead in knowledge-less society of 21st century in which we are. The Technology Vision 2035 document, I would request everyone, all the students should actually go through. This is available on site. You can download the soft copy. This is important for all of you to learn, to see what's likely to happen, what are our needs. And we need to be prepared for major disruptions like COVID that can happen at any time of our life. And education system has to respond quickly to this change. New education policy is the right step in this direction. Role of private investment is very important in both research and education. And I just wanted to mention private investment through the universities and colleges, that we've also started some major global level research projects in the university. For example, one is on nuclear fusion, which nobody in the country is doing except one national lab with funding coming from Silicon Valley. Second one is related to solving chronic health problem. Third related to global warming. Fourth is related to helping farmers with space technology. And fifth one is related to disability sector using brain computer interface. So all of this we are starting in the university with funding. At least 4 of them are with US funding coming in, and sometimes Mexico is also involved. So I will stop at this point. Thank you so much for giving this opportunity, and I apologize again for being late and the slide was not changing. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. It was very informative and covering all the aspects of AI. So nice of you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, sir, for your inspirational and knowledgeable words. It would really help all the participants for their future career. Today, we have with us the principal of Cummins College of Engineering for Women, Nagpur, Dr. Bharat Bhushan Joshi. Dr. Bharat Bhushan Joshi is a principal of Cummins College of Engineering for Women, Nagpur. He has more than 35 years of experience, 24 years in research and development. He was ex-joint director in DRDO. He developed 13 different very critical mechatronic systems for various weapon and missile systems. He has 10 years experience in academics at University of Pune and Rashtrasant Tukdoji Maharaj, Nagpur University. He also the past chairman of IIT Nagpur Center. Now I request to respected principal sir to address the gathering.
A very good morning to all of you. Today's chief guest, Dr. Prabhat Ranjan. He is very well known to me since 2016. And we were interacting when we were actually conducting one event called IFA. The convener of this particular STDP, Professor Sakshi Madam, the other coordinators, Professor Prasanna Lohe, the faculty who has joined as participants and dear students. For and then you would be able to use the whatever knowledge that you gain out of this 6 days STTP for any of your projects that you want to take up. Well, we planned this particular STTP with a view that as we are seeing that in many colleges, they are closing down the branch of electronics or electronics communication. And you know, it is rather changing its shape. It is rather changing its the way it used to look like, because now electronics won't be only electronics. It is not only electronics and telecommunication, but it is telecomputing, and which would be definitely be supported by the emerging technologies such as artificial intelligence, machine learning, deep learning, and so on. So we thought that we would conduct an STTP in such a manner that those who find that they are getting found redundant in their colleges, if they do this particular course and get the completion certificate, they are definitely going to find some place in the emerging technologies. As you have just now seen, in the last slide presented, last few slides presented by our chief guest, that the kind of tracks that they are running in their university, you know, now the same thing would become the kind of tracks would be coming in almost all the universities across India, and that is where, you know, the pioneer like Dr. Prabhat Ranjan is here today to talk to us, because he is the one, you know, who thinks always 15-20 years ahead of all of us. And that is how, you know, if you definitely look at the document which was prepared by TIFAC when he was as an executive director there, you will definitely find that yes, there is a lot of thing that can be done. And people like Anil Kakodkar, who were chairing this particular mission of preparing the India 2035 document under the coordinationship of Dr. Prabhat Ranjan, that document has come out beautiful. And you know, when I visited in 2016 to invite him for our one of the events called IFA, he gave me the hard copy, which was just released by Prime Minister then in one of the science congresses. And I still have that. And whenever I want to give a talk about anything which is on the emerging technology, I do refer to it. And I also tell my people that whenever you are thinking of establishing anything, any center of excellence, any new lab, we must refer to this booklet or a book, because this is the one which is going to give us the line of thoughts, or the guideline that has been laid out there would be useful, so that whatever we set it up, the center of excellence would definitely be of use for the people, for the students who are going to come in the future to us. And well, we are following that. And thanks a lot, sir, for being with us. I am really, really enthusiastic to see to it that the kind of keynote address that you have delivered will definitely trigger the thoughts about AI, ML, and all the emerging technologies which are needed by not only the computer engineers, but also by the electronics and the mechanical and the civil engineers. And this is going to be an STTP which is going to give you something different. So I, as a principal of Cummins College of Engineering, welcome all the participants to this STTP at Cummins College of Engineering. Well, it is good that we are meeting on a virtual platform, so that, you know, I am able to accommodate so many people on this particular STTP. Otherwise, you know, it would have been restricted to some 20-25 people. So thanks to, again, the pandemic situation. And we really are enthralled, and we are really going to see to it that you get what you want. And definitely the people who are going to deliver their addresses in the next 5-6 days is going to give you a good amount of knowledge, which definitely you can use for your future career. So with this note, I would like to stop here with a welcome and thanks to Dr. Prabhatranjan once again. Thank you. Over to Prasanna.
Thank you, Dr. Joshi.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Today, my words are not enough to express the gratitude on behalf of Cummins College of Engineering for Women. I would like to thank you, our guest speaker, who shared their expertise and valuable time with all of us. I would like to thank our management, principal, sir, for all words of wisdom that radiated a source of energy within us. We will ever remain grateful to you, and we thank you for being with us always. I am also thankful to all the participants who are joining this inauguration session. Here, I would declare the inauguration session is over. Here, I am requesting all the participants to join sharp at 1:20 p.m. for the next session. The session is of Dr. Rizwan Ahmed, sir, for again the keynote speaker for our artificial intelligence topic. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.